Welcome back. Well, the world has been reflecting on the 20 years since the death of the People's Princess. Dickie Arbiter was the Queen's press secretary right in the middle of the Diana years and guided her interaction with the media, and he joins us now live from London. Dickie Arbiter, welcome to the show. Yay. Take us back to your...
Where's the fanfare?
Yeah.
Where are the trumpets?
Take us back to your first meeting with Diana. What was your very first impression of her?
Well, my first impression, I was a reporter at the time, and I met her about 3 days before the wedding in 1981. I had a cup of tea with her and Prince Charles and a biscuit. And she was already labelled by the print media as being shy Di, but she was far from shy. She kept her head down, really, because she was 5'10", and a lot of people are shorter than 5'10", and she didn't like to make them feel inferior, so she kind of put her head down to put her at the same level. But she was pretty streetwise even then.
That's very interesting, Dickie, that you say she was so streetwise from an early age, because, you know, so we all felt like we knew her. The public just felt like, you know, you had this personal connection with her. What else was she like? What other sorts of perspectives do you have?
Well, she developed into a tremendous communicator. She was very touchy-feely. She was hands-on. She was incredibly good with people, whether they were newborn babies, they were tots, teenagers, adolescents, the aged, the infirm, the healthy. She was just very good with people. I mean, you guys, you had several visits with Charles and Diana to Australia, and she just fell into crowds. She just loved talking to people and enjoyed a laugh with people. She just liked people.
Dickie, you were there when Andrew Morton's explosive biography of Diana came out. Did you ever ask her if she was the source of the information, and was there any kind of blowback from that?
Well, it's quite interesting you ask that, because that book came out in June 1992. It was serialised in the British Sunday Times. We went on a 24-hour visit to Budapest. She wanted to do a special charity there. And I held a media briefing just before she arrived, and all they were interested in was, do you know about the book? Do you know whether Diana's helped? And I said, I don't know anything about the book. I don't know whether she's helped, but I'll ask her. And when she arrived at the venue, she had a comfort break, and I said to her, they're asking about the book, the Andrew Morton book. Did you help her? And she looked at me and she said, no, of course I didn't. And she told her brother-in-law she didn't help, and she told everybody else she didn't help. And it was about a year later that we discovered she did help. When it did get serialised in the Sunday Times, she phoned me at 5 o'clock in the morning. What do I do? What do I do? She said. I said, well, ma'am, you've already done it. I suggest you go and find a bottle of whiskey and start sipping from it and enjoy yourself, because the damage is done.
Yep. Dickie, do you believe that Prince Charles was ever jealous of the attention given to Diana?
I think there probably was a little bit of jealousy, because everywhere she went, there were adoring crowds cheering for her. I remember their very first visit together. He introduced her to the people of Wales in October 1981, the first Princess of Wales in almost 100 years. And they got out the car, and she went to one side of the road and everybody cheered. And he went to the other side of the road and they went, oh. And then they swapped over and we had the same thing.
Wow.
And he actually made a wonderful speech. He said, maybe I should have two wives, put them either side of the road and I'll walk down the middle and direct them.
Now, where were you when you heard the news of the car accident, and what was your first thought?
I was at home. It was 25 past 11 on a Saturday night. I had a call from CNN in Atlanta asking me about the crash, and I said, what crash? And as he was talking, I went into my living room and turned CNN on and was mesmerised by what I saw, and I thought, nobody can possibly survive that. And the television was on for the rest of the night, and I got a call from one of my colleagues at about quarter past three in the morning to say she'd gone. And within 25 minutes, I was at my desk in the office at Buckingham Palace, starting calling people, Windsor Castle, Palace of Holyrood House in Edinburgh, Sandringham House in Norfolk, saying, you better lower your flags to half-mast. Flags was another issue when it came to Buckingham Palace.
Now, did you actually like Princess Diana, Dickie?
Oh, I thought she was terrific. Although I was one of the Queen's press secretaries, I worked for Charles and Diana for my first 5 years. And Diana actually gave me a 50th birthday lunch in a private dining room at Kensington Palace. I was allowed to invite 20 friends. My family were there. She had party poppers, streamers, helium balloons. And right at the end, I've always been known for carrying a mobile phone. I've always had a mobile phone. Sometimes it's gone off in the most embarrassing of moments, but it's always been with me. And Diana's chef, Mervyn Witcherly, actually baked a cake. You're all probably too young to remember the brick.
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm not.
And icing on the cake, in white icing, the cake was blue, white icing, said, "You're never alone when Dickie's got his phone." Aww. It was a great time, great occasion. Aww, she's never
wonderful.
Done it for anybody else.
Aww, yeah, right. That's wonderful. So yeah. Special. Is there anything, I mean, as I had said earlier, we feel like we all know or knew Princess Diana. Is there something that would surprise us about her that you know, that you could share with us?
I don't think there is anything that you'd be surprised about. I mean, you've seen her in the flesh. She's good with people. She had a great sense of humour. She was good for a joke. A lot of the jokes were pretty risque. Ah. Certainly not for repeating on a family station, a family programme. But she did enjoy a good laugh. And the better the joke, the more raucous the laugh was. And this usually happened at about 36,000 feet coming back from some trip overseas in an aircraft.
Diana's former butler recently caused some controversy by saying that Kate Middleton doesn't have the X factor that Princess Diana had when she was alive. What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's very unfair to compare the Duchess of Cambridge to Diana. Diana was a one-off. There is only one Diana. There will never be another Diana. It's a bit like Queen Elizabeth II, our queen, yours and mine. Mm. There will only be one Elizabeth II. There will only be one person like her to live beyond 91, to still be working. Diana was a one-off. There will never be another Diana, and it is wrong to compare Catherine to her. Catherine does things in her own style, in her own way, and she will develop as she does more and more as with the royal firm. But please, let's judge Catherine as her own person rather than trying to compare her to somebody else.
Mm. Yeah, fair enough.
Her own merits.
Now, Dickie, just going back to those events 20 years ago, the palace was, of course, heavily criticised for its initial response to Diana's death. Should the Queen have reacted sooner, or the palace and the royal family have been more effusive in their response?
Well, it's quite interesting you ask that, because in a documentary on BBC on Sunday, Prince Harry said the Queen was absolutely right in staying at Balmoral. I've said for 20 years now that she was absolutely right staying up there. The fact, yes, she was on holiday, but William and Harry were on holiday as well. And they had the opportunity of being with their grandparents, who are very wise. They counseled them. They gave them the space they needed to go and vent their anger on the estate before coming back to London. And if you remember when they came back to London on the Thursday, they walked around and looked at the floral tributes in Kensington Gardens. They maintained a tremendous composure.
Oh,
they
amazing.
Could never have done that had their grandparents not been there and had their dad not been there. And to then walk behind the Cung Garage 2 days later, again maintaining a composure. Mm. Harry said the other day, he said he could not understand why people were weeping and wailing for somebody that they didn't actually know. Mm. And this was what the scene was like in London. People were wailing. They were wailing when the funeral cortege went past. And, you know, those poor young boys at the time, 15 and 12 respectively, they just didn't understand what it was all about.
It's extraordinary. You even see people crying about it now who never met Diana 20 years later. Mm. The Queen famously is very committed to knowing the public mood, knowing the mood of her subjects and reading the public mood. So do you think that she misread the outrage or the upset or the backlash against the royal family in the wake of Diana's death? Or do you think that she deliberately, I suppose, wore that to absorb some of that before she did respond? Which do you think it was?
Well, right at the very beginning, we were all caught on the hop. Not just the royal family, but we at Buckingham Palace. The press were also caught on the hop in the public reaction. The first bunch of flowers was put up against the railings of Buckingham Palace at around about 10 to 5 in the morning. Wow. And then they just kept on coming in. I lived at Kensington Palace at the time, and when I got back that night, very late, there was a buzz in the park. There were hundreds of people in the park. There was already a partial carpet of flowers and night candles burning. So we'd all misjudged, and the media included. Was the Queen au fait? Well, she could see what was happening. Her concern was really sheltering William and Harry from any news media, whether it was television or newspapers. And she did that. She did a good job of that. There were those who were saying, well, she should have paid tribute at the beginning of the week. Mm-hmm. The trouble with doing that is then she would have been asked and told that she's got to do something at the end of the week. Mm-hmm. And she kind of gauges the mood, and she gauges the mood correctly. She came back to London on Friday. She went to St. James's Palace first to look at the books of condolence. When she got out the car there, well-wishers, mourners greeted her with polite applause. She did a walkabout. She went to Buckingham Palace. She walked into an enclosure. Again, there was polite applause. She talked with people for about 40 minutes. She laid their flowers down. And then virtually an hour and a half later, she paid tribute to Diana. And that went a long way, obviously, to change the mood. And the trouble is that the whole thing was whipped up in the middle of the week by our great British press. They go out and ask a question. They say to a mourner, well, do you think the Queen should be down here? And they're going to say, yeah, of course she should. But if they say the Queen's at Balmoral, William and Harry are there, their grandparents, they are counselling, they are looking after their grandchildren. Mm. Do you think as a grandparent they're doing the right thing? You get a different answer.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep, they were torn, weren't they? The duties of a grandmother and of the Queen. Dickie Arbiter, thank you so much for joining us today. Yes. You've been fascinating.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.